agenda items 3 and 4 in private. Thank you. And our second agenda item is to take evidence on our ongoing consideration of Scotland's humanitarian response to the crisis in Ukraine. And we are joined this morning by Neil Gray, MSP, Minister for Culture, Europe and International Development, and Minister with Special Responsibility for Refugees from Ukraine. He's joined this morning by Kirsten McPhee, Head of Ministerial Support and Correspondence, Ukraine Settlement Directorate at the Scottish Government, and Will Tyler Gregg, Interim Deputy Director, Policy Engagement and Finance Division, Ukraine Resettlement Directorate, Scottish Government. And Minister, could I invite you to make an opening statement?
Thank you very much indeed, Convener. Good morning, colleagues. Thank you very much for the opportunity to update you on our work to welcome and support those fleeing the illegal war in Ukraine. More than 8 million people have been displaced from Ukraine. This mass movement of people remains the largest in Europe since World War II. The Scottish Government condemns Russia's invasion and the crisis that it has created, and we stand in solidarity with the people of Ukraine. Sadly, as evidenced by the numbers applying, the Scottish Government's super sponsor scheme has provided a desperately needed route to safety and sanctuary. Going well beyond our commitment to welcome at least 3,000 people, Scotland has sponsored more than 23,200 arrivals, the majority of which through the super sponsor scheme, which is more per head of population than any other part of the UK. The scale and pace of this national response is unprecedented and awe-inspiring. I would therefore like to recognise and thank and recognise the enormous kindness and unwavering support of the Scottish people who have welcomed our friends from Ukraine into their homes and communities. Furthermore, I'd like to acknowledge the work of our partners, local authorities, the third sector, community groups, who continue to provide that warm Scots welcome. Responding to a challenge of this scale has required significant resource. This year, the Scottish Government will spend around £200 million in short-term accommodation, support for councils and funding to the third sector. Next year, we will invest a further £70 million to ensure communities continue to receive help to rebuild their lives. We do not want anyone to spend any longer than necessary in temporary accommodation. A settled home is clearly the best outcome. And I recently launched a new campaign for volunteer hosts, and we continue to work closely with local authorities and registered social landlords to bring forward longer-term housing options. Settled accommodation is just one part of our approach. We continually take steps to improve support to displaced people and help integration in our communities, to access education, employment support, healthcare, and any other services they may need. So to conclude, while I hope those who wish to return can do so safely in time, the Scottish Government's message to all those seeking sanctuary remains clear. Scotland is your home for as long as you need it to be. Thank you, Convener.
Thank you very much, Minister. I wonder if I could open by asking a question about the length of time that this is now taking in terms of what the expectation was at the very start, that this would be a temporary and short-term support for Ukrainian people when it was considered that the war wouldn't last for very long. That is significantly changed now, and people are moving from what was considered to be a kind of very, very short-term option to now looking to realistically be in Scotland for perhaps we want as short a time as possible, of course, but it may be a considerable time. So for those that are moving from hotel and the ships into to more permanent accommodation, and also the fact that we're now hitting the kind of 6 month time where initial hosting arrangements may not continue for whatever reason. So that's a bit of a pinch point at the moment on the services, while we're still receiving more Ukrainians coming. And of course, we don't know what the scale of that might be, because I also understand from the consul that there are people with visas who have yet to come, but have received visas to come here. So I just wondered if your plans have changed and the policy has developed over time, and you're now looking at a different model going forward?
Thanks very much indeed, Convener. You're absolutely right. I think everybody sadly expected at the beginning that this was going to be a short war. We have to pay tribute to the resilience, the bravery of the people of Ukraine for the fact that they have defended their country so incredibly well against the illegal Russian invasion, the latest invasion, of course, because Russia had annexed Crimea in 2014. But I think everybody's expectation was that this was going to be a short and temporary situation. We are in a very different situation now. We're approaching a year, which is going to be a very poignant moment. And I'm happy to talk about some of the aspects that we're planning to do in terms of marking that particularly tricky anniversary for Ukrainians that are here in Scotland. But there has had to be, obviously, in the result of that, a change in approach. And you've seen that in the way that the super sponsor scheme has been organised. We had a review of the super sponsor scheme at the time that I had to pause it due to the unprecedented demand that was placed upon it during the summer months, when it was the only viable route to come into the United Kingdom. And there were 16 interventions proposed as part of that review, the review led by Professor Linda Bald. We've made significant progress on the majority of those areas in that very short time since that review was published, including looking at the £50 million fund to bring forward longer-term accommodation, including looking at support for people through the private rented sector, modular accommodation. There are a number of things that we're moving to make the scheme sustainable and durable for the long term. And as I say, because sadly, we are in a situation for Ukrainians where they're having to be here in Scotland for their safety longer than was anticipated. And we'll continue to look to ensure that we're doing everything possible, reflecting on some of the areas that the Consul General or the head of the consular office in Edinburgh, Mr. Cousley, has suggested, and reflecting on work that we're doing with our local authority partners and the third sector as well.
Thank you very much. And since you mentioned it, Minister, I wonder, with that year anniversary approaching, what is the government doing to engage with the Ukrainian community here in Scotland to mark that?
So there are a number of events planned for that week, both planned by the government, planned by Edinburgh City Council, planned by the Association of Ukrainians in Great Britain, Edinburgh. A number of events, including church services. There's going to be an event here in Parliament that's co-sponsored by myself and the presiding officer. On the Tuesday night, the Scottish Government will be leading a debate on the Thursday, the day before the anniversary. There's going to be wreath laying and processions, in not just here in Edinburgh, but across Scotland as well. So there's going to be a number of events that will hopefully allow the people that are here from Ukraine to see the solidarity of feeling that there is here from Scotland. But also, I hope, to remind people across Scotland that the war continues. As you say, Convener, there are more than 13,000 people who still hold a visa to travel that are yet to travel. We have people arriving from Ukraine every day still, although the scheme has been paused. I think ensuring that it's high enough in the public's consciousness that this is still an issue that is requiring a significant amount of intervention and support is really important, not least of all so that our friends from Ukraine that are here that have suffered great trauma will still be worried about family members or have lost family members, will want to make sure that they're marking that event appropriately.
Thank you very much, Minister. Can I move to questions to the committee and can I bring in Mr. Cameron?
Thank you, Convener. Minister, welcome to the committee today. Thank you for coming. A few weeks ago, we heard evidence from the consul that Ukrainians in Scotland are still finding it hard to register with GPs and dentists. And he, in fact, warned that some have been forced to leave Scotland and go to Poland to get dental treatment. Additionally, in their briefing to the committee, Just Right Scotland have warned that some Ukrainians in Scotland are importing their own medications as they don't know how to obtain prescriptions from NHS Scotland. Given the time that's elapsed, it might be thought that these bureaucratic barriers should have been sorted by now. And I'm just, I suppose, asking for your reaction to that and also a plea to give this your urgent attention and ensure that these barriers to medical services are lifted.
I thank Mr. Cameron for that question, and I have had the opportunity now to meet Mr. Cousley and to welcome him to Scotland to be able to set out the number of areas of intervention that the Scottish Government, local authority partners and others that are working to support Ukrainians. I hope to be able to visit the Glasgow ship with him next week in order to talk about some of the move-on operations that are going on at Ambition, but also to discuss some of those areas that he raised. I think it was, I can't remember which authority it was that was asked this question when they appeared before you last week, but there was confirmation that from local authority partners, and I can give it again today, that support services that are on board the ships or in hotels or advice to hosts in terms of how people should or can register with doctors and dentists is readily available. If there has been a breakdown for some individuals in that case, that is obviously unfortunate, and I'm looking to ensure that the consul, the head of the consular services, Mr. Cousley, is aware of the support services that are in place, because you're absolutely right, it would be unacceptable if there wasn't a clear pathway for people to register with a doctor or what have you, but those support services are in place. They're entitled to register with doctors and dentists the same as any other Scottish resident, and I'm confident that those support services are in place to ensure those pathways are clear.
Thank you for that. Another thing that he raised was the topic of accessing private rental accommodation. And he requested, the consul requested, that local authorities act as rent guarantors. Last week, we heard from the Highland Council that they operate a rental guarantee scheme. Mm-hmm. And I think also Edinburgh Glasgow said they're part of a national working group looking at the issue. Can you advise when that working group might report, and what action can the Scottish Government take to assist any local authority in terms of introducing a rental guarantee scheme?
Yeah, obviously we're hoping that that working group can report as quickly as possible. It's one of the 16 interventions that the review of the super sponsor scheme looked at was about support for private rented accommodation. Obviously, there are challenges and high levels of competition within the private rented sector in Scotland already. So it's one avenue of potential long-term accommodation that we're looking at supporting Ukrainians to move into. 18 of the 32 local authorities currently offer some form of support in terms of guarantee schemes for the private rented sector, and we're obviously looking at what more we might be able to do in terms of ensuring that we can extend that further. As I said, it's part of the review of the super sponsor scheme that Linda Bald led, and we'll continue to do that work in consort with my colleague Shona Robeson and her housing officials as well.
Thank you.
Mr. Roscoe.
Yeah, thanks, Convener. I wanted to ask you about access to private rented sector accommodation and whether there are creative solutions that are starting to come through on that issue. So I was aware that in Spain, I think in 2015, Spanish cities were calling on the banks to make available, you know, empty vacant properties that were in their asset portfolios at that time for refugees. I'm wondering what the options are in Scotland. I think you mentioned modular accommodation earlier on. I'm aware that within rural Scotland as well, we have empty properties, empty homes. I've got an empty bed and breakfast in the community that I live in, so it's frustrating to see homes and houses that are in our communities but are unavailable for general private rented sector accommodation, but particularly for this population of Ukrainian displaced people who often want to stay in communities and continue to thrive and be a part of those communities. So interesting what creative ideas are being developed to really meet their needs right now.
I thank Mr. Ruskell for that question because it really strikes at to the heart of the work that we are doing right now to try to make sure that people have suitable long-term accommodation to move into from temporary accommodation, whether that's hosted or hotels or the two ships. The £50 million fund that was launched by the First Minister last year has had really good take-up so far. The projects that have been agreed were close to 750 properties being brought back into use. That could be allocated to Ukrainians, in some cases dedicated to Ukrainians, others that will also provide legacy accommodation options for domestic homelessness as well. We've got a number of applications to that in the pipeline from authorities across Scotland. I would always say that there is more that could be done and encourage local authorities or owners of buildings that might be able to be repurposed to consider whether or not there is something, as Mr. Ruskell describes it, creative that could be done to repurpose it to offer accommodation, either to respond directly to the situation for Ukrainians or indeed to, and additionally to provide legacy accommodation for domestic homelessness as well. We're also, as Mr. Ruskell points out, looking at modular accommodation. We're not unique in that situation. The Irish government has already got modular accommodation in use. The Welsh government, I know, are also in advanced stages of introducing modular accommodation as well, because we need to look at any and all factors to try to ensure that we're providing appropriate and sustainable accommodation for people arriving from Ukraine. But again, my encouragement to local authorities, registered social landlords and others is to look at empty homes, look at empty buildings that could be repurposed, and speak to my colleagues in government and my officials to see whether or not there is an opportunity for a bid to be made for that capital funding to ensure that those properties are brought back into use.
Okay, thanks very much for that. So another issue that's been raised with the committee is that we're hearing that there have been delays to in-country applications for the Ukrainian visa scheme from Ukrainians who were without leave to remain when the war actually began. Mm. So I wonder if that's something that you're aware of, and whether there's been discussions with UK government about how we can ensure that there aren't any delays. I mean, I think initially with the committee we had concerns about seasonal workers who may be captured by that, who'd maybe left seasonal employment and were without leave to remain, and then would be sort of trapped, you know, unable to go through other routes. But yeah, it was a surprise to see evidence coming in to suggest that there is still an issue there.
I think Mr. Ruskell's right. There is still an issue there. Obviously, the UK government has the responsibility for all aspects of the processing and organisation of visas, whether it's for Ukrainians or others that are looking to come to Scotland. And we make regular representations to the UK government around the processing of visas for Ukrainians and others, to ensure that they are happening as timeously as possible. The Ukraine Extension Scheme was intended to try to bridge that gap that Mr. Ruskell has pointed out, but if he has direct evidence of areas where that is continuing to be an issue, then I would be happy to bring that up with Home Office contacts that we're meeting regularly.
Okay, thanks, appreciate that. And then another issue is about a potential path to permanent settlement in the UK, and in the vast majority of Ukrainian people we meet wish to return home, but no doubt some of them may wish to stay, and I think understanding what that path to permanent settlement might be is important for them to weigh up options. So I'm just wondering, is there clarity on that, and what can you do to try and get clarity for those who have the power to decide?
Again, this is a very pertinent and timid question that Mr. Ruskell asks, convener, because this was something that I raised directly with Felicity Buchan, the new minister with responsibility for the Ukraine scheme in the UK government. I'm concerned that we're approaching a year since the start of the latest invasion by Russia. Therefore, we're approaching a year since some people will have received visas. That means that they're a third of the way through their time here in the UK. It's a three-year visa. And for some, Mr. Ruskell is right, they will be wanting to return to Ukraine as soon as it is safe for them to do so. They've got property or family, they've got jobs or what have you to return to. There is an emotional tie there, understandably, to want to return to help to rebuild. But for others, I know from speaking to Ukrainians, they want to rebuild their life here in Scotland, and they have enjoyed their stay thus far, and they want to stay longer term. So it was a question that I raised with Felicity Buchan. I'm not confident that thinking has progressed as yet in the UK government. It's something that I will continue to raise, because we want to make sure that people who are here right now have the certainty of knowing what their status is. I would encourage colleagues, if they have evidence of where there are concerns that have been raised of that, to ensure that I'm aware of that so that I can continue to raise that with UK colleagues.
Okay, thanks.
Dr. Allen.
Thank you, Convener. One issue that's been raised by the Scottish Refugee Council is about the issue of arrivals and how to welcome people. And to do that effectively in a way that provides some of the information we're talking about. Now, I realise some of this involves cooperation with the UK Border Force, but the Scottish Refugee Council did mention to us a lack of predictability of arrivals being one of their main challenges, and how they no longer receive any information from the UK Border Force and therefore have no access to pre-arrival information. Now, I realise that's for the UK Border Force to organise, but can you say anything about where the Scottish Government comes into the greeting and arrival process, and how you try to overcome some of these challenges of coordination?
I thank Dr. Allen for that question, because it has been an issue for us throughout the last year, or coming up to a year, of responding to the crisis in Ukraine and the movement of people, and Scottish Refugee Council, who we fund to support us in terms of that arrival support mechanisms at our welcome hubs, are absolutely right. As I think you also received evidence last week from local authorities around the fact that the unpredictability of arrivals was one of the greatest challenges, particularly the peak time of arrivals during the last summer, when we had high numbers of people arriving. And it contrasts completely compared to the resettlement programmes for those arriving from Afghanistan and Syria. That is a challenge, there's no doubt, and we've been looking to respond as best we can, but has meant, for instance, us having to ensure that we have sufficient temporary accommodation to match the trend of arrivals, which in some cases meant that at some points through the last year we have had an over-provision of temporary accommodation. Sometimes we've been stretched in terms of temporary accommodation, but it's made it far more difficult for us to plan, because we've not had that level of certainty and correspondence. So it's difficult and a challenge, but I think thus far I need to pay tribute to my colleagues at government and local authority teams at the Scottish Refugee Council, who have been responding so admirably to ensure that people are given the appropriate welcome when they arrive. The welcome desks at the transit points at Edinburgh Glasgow Airport in particular, the train stations, to ensure that there were people there to greet folk who are arriving from Ukraine, messages and information translated into Ukrainian, and then a very clear pathway of where they were going and where they were heading as part of that welcome operation. And as I say, and I said in my introduction, could not have done that without the partnership of support through the welcome hubs, those that have been involved with local authorities and SRC. But of course, happy to speak to Scottish Refugee Council, or indeed the Border Force again, around how that could be operated in a better way in future.
Thank you. And a completely different issue, but one that was raised by the Council was the question of people who are looking for employment in Scotland and who feel, with some justification, that they're underemployed perhaps because their qualifications haven't been recognised for them to work here. Again, I realise some of this touches on reserved matters, but I'm interested to know what progress there has been in that conversation to try and ensure that there's mutual recognition of qualifications where possible to allow employment.
Dr. Allen's absolutely right. People are arriving here with very high levels of qualification, very well skilled. Obviously, we're looking to try to make sure that while they are here, they are able to utilise those skills, because we've got labour market challenges here, obviously, and there have been discussions with the UK government about mutual recognition of qualifications to try to make sure that people, you know, such as medics that are arriving, are able to quickly go through the necessary transition to be able to practice here in Scotland. And we'll continue to have those discussions as those particular areas that are raised with us are pointed out. I'd like to bring Kirsten in at this stage, so she's going to
thank you, Minister. Just on that, we have had a bit of an update from the Law Society of Scotland. They're doing a lot of work with Ukrainian solicitors, both to help them support practising here under their home title, but also to re-qualify in Scots law if they so wish. And that includes waiving examination and exemption fees. It includes free access to English language courses. And they're running things like shadowing mentor schemes to support that as well. So we are linked into that, and we are doing what we can to support that here.
Thank you.
Thank you. Ms. Boyack.
Very much, Convener. I would be very interested in getting an update on the recommendations, the 16 recommendations from the super sponsor scheme for the committee, because that was, I think, November last year that was put out, and also to get an update on the September launch of the £50 million scheme. And that the issue you mentioned there about repurposing and accessing homes, 43,000 empty homes in Scotland, and for us in Edinburgh it's over 9,000. So in terms of a cost-effective way to get access to homes, I think there's a huge interest in that. And I think particularly because for those that have been hosts, you know, given we're up almost at the 1 year recognition of the devastation, there will be so many houses and communities that are bombed and destroyed. So it isn't now a short-term issue, as you've correctly acknowledged. It's how we give people that medium-term support. So if we could get an update, particularly on the £50 million scheme and the extent to which we can use it to repurpose existing homes that are empty, that would be cost-effective. But also just to say a bit about, could you say something about support for hosts, continuing support? Many of you know, over their 6 months, are you bringing new hosts into play? Just talk about what's actually happening now. Thank you.
I thank Ms. Boyett for that question. I'd be happy, I think in the interest of time, rather than me going through, as I'd be happy to do, but going through each and every item of recommendations, 16 recommendations and the progress that we've been made on each, I'd be happy to write to the committee detailing each of the 16 recommendations and the follow-up work that has been progressed in the 3 months since the recommendations were published, if that would be satisfactory to the committee convener. The one item of that is around two items there that Ms. Boyack has raised. One is around the £50 million fund, and the other is around support for hosts. In terms of the £50 million fund, as I'd outlined previously, we're approaching 750 units that have been brought back into use, £10 million of the fund that has been granted to local authority partners. We've got a large number of applications that are being progressed and also registers of interest, including from Edinburgh City Council, around potential opportunities for a bid to go in to repurpose or bring back into use properties. The issue around empty homes is one that has been around for some time. Obviously, these are privately owned, largely. If they're in the social rented sector, the £50 million fund should address them. But the privately owned homes is a challenge. There are opportunities there to buy those back, but that requires quite a lot of discussion, negotiation, and information around who owns them and whether or not they're actually willing or in a position to sell them or bring them back into use. In terms of support for hosts, first of all, I have to say, express my utmost gratitude to the thousands of people across Scotland who have put their name forward and are hosting people across Scotland. I've got friends and who are doing that, and I've been able to see for myself the incredible generosity that there is there, but also the appreciation that there is amongst Ukrainians for the fact that people have opened their homes. There has been an updated appeal
for new hosts to come forward, which has been well taken up thus far. But we would always look to encourage anyone who thinks that they might be in a position to offer a place of sanctuary to a Ukrainian who has been displaced to come forward, and we'll do what we can, obviously, to provide the necessary support that's in place. It offers me the opportunity as well, Convener, to reflect on the fact that the UK Government has partially acceded to the calls from the Scottish and Welsh Government to increase support for those that are in hosting arrangements. I'm very well aware of the challenges that people are facing in terms of energy costs, the cost crisis. And we had recommended that the UK Government immediately increase the £350 thank you payment to reflect the fact that inflation is running incredibly high. They partially acquiesced to that to increase the thank you payment to £500 after 12 months that somebody has been hosting for, which does not meet the requirements that we feel there are to maintain hosting arrangements or to encourage new people to come forward. We would have wanted to see that go much further. If you look at our arrivals data, the majority of the people that have arrived in Scotland, either in hosting arrangements or otherwise, arrived around the summer. So for people to make that 12-month hosting commitment, we won't remake that until the summertime, and we know that the pressure is now. So I've continued, again, I referenced earlier the meeting that I had with Felicity Buchan, I think it was last week or the week before, where I impressed, as did Jane Hutt, that my counterpart in Wales, impressed upon the importance of the Treasury releasing further finance to support hosts, and will continue to make those calls. There were other calls that were made in there around local authority support as well, which I'm sure we'll turn to later in the discussion.
Yeah, very good that you will give us that update and the recommendations, because we don't have time to let you run through in
I could
entirety.
If you want, but I suspect in the interest of time, we best not.
So it was to come back to the housing issues, and I should put on record my register of interest, a former employment. I think it's been very much seen as a win-win, because you've got a housing crisis within a housing crisis. So that support to get empty homes back in use is not straightforward, but in terms of the £50 million fund, it could potentially be really significant. And I'm glad you've put on the record the issues about hosts, because I have had constituents worried about, does the money run out after 6 months? So I think while it may not be enough, it's actually important to let people know what support is there. You also mentioned modular housing in your introductory remarks. I think most of us were assuming that had now been ruled out with the £50 million focus. There's a lot of concerns about that. Do you want to say anything more about it on the record?
No, we've not ruled it out. We're still looking at the possibility of a pilot to look at the appropriateness of modular housing. There are obviously concerns that we want to make sure we can overcome if we are looking at modular housing around homelessness standards, around making sure that we have appropriate accommodation being utilised. But we're looking very closely at the work that's been done in Ireland and looking to liaise further with our colleagues in Wales, who are also in advanced discussions around utilising modular accommodation. There are a wide range of potential options, ranging from very temporary solutions to longer term options that can be purchased that have a life in the decades that can be utilised, which we're very interested in exploring further. And once we have taken a decision, I'd be happy to make sure that the committee is updated on any progress that has been made on that front.
I think that'd be very helpful, because I think there's a huge amount of concerns about it. Mm. And you mentioned yourself the issue about local authorities, capacity issues, schools, people being able to get the health support, apart from just the welfare of people being in modular accommodation. So I think we'd be very keen to see any updates on that, because of the real worries about that. And that's why the focus on bringing existing homes back into use, which are safe mm. and which are integrated in communities, is something that, as I say, potentially a win-win in terms of giving. When I look to Edinburgh, we've got people from Syria and Afghanistan who are still in temporary accommodation. So this has to be a now urgent issue that requires investment. Thank you.
Ms. Boyack's absolutely right, Convener. And the issues that she raises are around ensuring there is access to appropriate services, ensuring there is appropriate living accommodation, are ones that we are absolutely considering and are the key parts, the key considerations for us in deciding both if we are to go ahead and proceed, where these sites might be located, but also in terms of ensuring the appropriateness of the accommodation as well. And I'd be happy, as I say, to when we take a decision or when we progress any of those matters, as I've done in terms of the ships, to give confidence to colleagues, happy to ensure that the committee is furnished with those details and also the opportunity to visit any potential sites that we're looking at.
Thank you. Ms. Minto.
Thank you, Convener, and thank you, Minister. You've touched in some of your evidence about cooperation and coordination with other governments across the UK and also with Ireland. I wonder if you could expand a wee bit more on that. And I'm also interested to delve a bit more into the change in the council funding, the decrease from £10,500 to £5,900, as mandated by the UK government. So I'd be interested to get your thoughts on how that's going to impact local authorities here.
Thank you. I thank Ms. Minto for that question. First of all, in terms of the international and cross-government, intergovernment cooperation, any international visit that I have been on of late, whether that's in Brussels, in Dublin, in Poland, Germany, all have had an element around discussions around their particular response to the situation in Ukraine. It's been evident to me, as I set out in my introduction, that this is the largest movement of people on the European continent since the Second World War. It's a crisis that people could not prepare for and are responding to as best as possible. And it is a Europe-wide challenge that we are all facing, that we're all looking to examples of best practice elsewhere to see where other countries, including our own, are trying to make sure that we're responding in the best possible way for those that have fled war. There is very strong cooperation and discussion with Welsh Government colleagues, for instance. We're very much on the same page in terms of responding. There's a difference in scale of arrival, obviously, and then again a difference in scale of arrival in the upper direction in terms of the discussions that we've had with the Irish Government, who have obviously were part of the European nations that waived visas, visa requirements, and so have had a very large number of Ukrainians arrive compared to what we have had in Scotland or elsewhere in the UK. And there are shared challenges there in terms of access to housing, access to services, other similar issues in terms of making sure that we're having an appropriate response. So the challenges that we're facing here in Scotland are not unique, is what I'm looking to say. But in terms of the financial situation that Ms. Minto has described, it is a huge worry to me. I know it is a major worry to local authorities here in Scotland, I know that came through in evidence last week. It's also a huge worry to Welsh Government colleagues and, I believe, the Local Government Association in England as well, because Ms. Minto is right. The local authority tariff support is reducing from £10,500 per person to £5,900 as of January. But thereafter, there is no year two tariff of support for local authorities, unlike the Syria scheme, unlike the Afghan scheme. It's been replaced by a one-off fund of £150 million across the UK that we are still to understand what the allocation of it will be. But our assumption is that it will be a tenth of the value of the year one tariff funding per person. So the 10,500 was already a stretch for our local authority partners who are asking, we're asking to do a significant amount of support in terms of education, in terms of housing, social work support, trauma support, you name it. And actually the conversation that I mentioned with my counterpart, the UK government, Felicity Buchan, there was even more that she was suggesting local government should or could be doing, which met with some frustration from myself, because while we're asking our local authorities to do more, people are still arriving, we are seeing funding from the UK government to support that dropping, as I say, by up to a tenth for this second year coming. I hope it's not too late. I hope we can impress on Treasury colleagues the fact that they have done a huge amount in terms of the military support, and that I grant, and I take my hat off to the UK government for the military support that they've provided Ukraine, which is amongst world leading, and you know, credit where it's due for that. But we also must ensure that we are appropriately supporting the humanitarian response too, and I've got real grave concerns that this cut in funding will not meet the expectation of meeting those humanitarian concerns. And I'm happy to bring my colleague Will Tyler-Greg in at this stage.
Just to build on the Minister's comments there, that the education tariff is another element that we understand will be ceased, and there's no current plan for replacement. And we've asked for clarity around whether the Scottish Government would receive any uplift in Barnetted consequentials. We're yet to receive a firm answer on that, and obviously that is concerning. And the earlier comments around the uplift and thank you payments is obviously another added element. And you know, the majority of hosts, 95% in an ONS survey, reported struggling to meet the costs for utilities and basics like bedding and toiletries. Mm-hmm. So it's going to hit, you know, communities, hosts, children in school, and of course, children in school is one of the four sort of foremost ways of helping integrate a family. Mm-hmm. So it's obviously concerning.
Yeah, thank you both for that very comprehensive answer. I think it really hits home actually when you realise the magnitude of what is going on across our local authorities to support Ukrainian families that are here, and also through our third sector groups as well. And I know my thanks goes out to all of the hard work that's happening there to ensure that people are welcomed. And the other thing, I spoke 2 weeks ago to the consul, Kusli, was about the heritage and the culture of the Ukrainians that are living in Scotland just now. And I think it is important for us all to mark the anniversary of the start of this illegal conflict. But I think we've also got to recognise the importance of the culture that these families are bringing to us. And one of his suggestions was looking at Ukrainian holidays and however we could support local authorities to recognise that. So that's, I'd like to hear your thoughts on how given cultures also in your job title, how we can support the Ukrainians there, and also given the length of the conflict, given the damage that's happened, how Scotland can continue to support the country to rebuild once this dreadful conflict is ended.
I thank Ms. Minto again for that question. There are a number of aspects I want to touch on. The first is I get to reiterate the thanks and the appreciation of the work that's gone on in local authorities across Scotland to respond to this. They've had some experience on a smaller scale in terms of the Syrian resettlement work, and the resettlement officers across Scotland have done an exemplary job in terms of supporting hosts, supporting Ukrainians, and ensuring that everything possible is done to facilitate schooling, housing, etc. And we've had very close cooperation and work support through with individual local authorities directly, as you'd expect, but also through COSLA, mm-hmm. who we have regular meetings with as well, both at ministerial and senior official level as well. Ms Minto is also right in terms of recognising the fact that and celebrating the fact that Ukrainians arriving here bring with them cultural diversity. It's something that we celebrate in Scotland. We should not also take it for granted that we need to make sure that that is continued to be appreciated. Mm-hmm. The work that is done by existing and growing Ukrainian community groups, I mentioned the Association of Ukrainians in Great Britain, their Edinburgh branch, there's now a Glasgow branch as well. You know, Hannah has been recognised with awards, as is the Ukrainian club in Edinburgh, and deservedly so, because they are doing fantastic work to support our work, to support Ukrainians that have arrived here, to continue to celebrate Ukrainian culture. And any suggestions that there are, either from Mr. Cousley or from others, in terms of what more we can do in terms of supporting that, obviously more than happy to look at that and to ensure that we are providing that support and that warm welcome that people absolutely deserve.
And into the future, how can Scotland's cultural side support perhaps the rebuilding? Mm.
Yeah, so there was a conference held here at the Scottish Parliament with heritage and cultural organisations from Ukraine. We heard very harrowing accounts of the cultural vandalism and destruction that you will have heard as well, and the convener heard around the cultural vandalism and destruction of monuments and other sites of cultural significance in Ukraine. There's a clear targeting of those sites by Russian forces to try to wipe Ukraine and everything that Ukraine stands for from the face of the earth, which you know, I would suggest should be in the category of investigation for a war crime. We'll continue to work directly with colleagues from Ukraine on the culture side around what we can do to support that. In terms of rebuilding, one of the meetings that I had when I was in Brussels at the end of last year was with the Committee of the Regions around what we can do in partnership around the rebuilding work, because there is a leading role that the Committee of the Regions has taken to coordinate that recovery support, and we haven't had advanced discussions as yet, because we're still in the situation of the war, but we would be looking to do what we can, depending on what the demand is, either to offer special practical support or otherwise, to ensure that Ukraine can rebuild when the war is over and Ukraine has maintained its borders and boundaries.
Thank you.
I wonder if I could go back for a supplementary question around the thank you payments as they stand, Minister, and the my understanding is from what you said there are going to be two levels, and hosts will qualify after 12 months, but I know that some hosts will already be on a second, possibly third, hosting arrangements, so by nature there's a break in that process. So I'm curious to know how that has been managed, if there's a sort of 12-month limit. And it does seem strange that, you know, the expenses are here and now for everyone, that, you know, that disparity could discourage people from stepping up.
Kavira, you're absolutely right. It's disappointing that there was an acknowledgement, a recognition that there was more needed to be done to support our hosts. And to give credit where it's due to the UK government, they have acknowledged that. The disappointing element is the fact that it's been kicked down the road in terms of when that support starts, which for many people will not be until long into the summer. And also confusion as to, you know, when the qualification will actually come in. And I'll bring my colleague in and try to provide some clarification on that. We continue to impress, as does the Welsh Government. This is not, again, something that it's just the Scottish Government trying to impress on UK colleagues of the need of this intervention. It's also something that the previous minister with responsibility for Ukraine, Richard Harrington, also acknowledged and said publicly that he wanted to see support payments happen and happen faster. But we'll continue to do what we can, but I'll bring my colleague Will Tyler Gregg in at this stage.
So the UK government's confirmed that time spent in short-term accommodation will contribute towards a 12-month uplift, eventual uplift. So in other words, any placement in country, whether it's in temporary accommodation with a first host, a second host, a third host, will all eventually add up to 12 months. And at that point, the host at 12 months will receive the uplifted payment. My worry is how that gets navigated by councils.
So someone could have someone in their house for 10 months, but so the money follows the...
It does.
The person, but
it
the
does.
Thank you is to...
It's certainly not intuitive, and my concern and the Minister's concern and the Welsh Government have been clear that the implementation of that scheme will be quite difficult for councils to track, if in other words, that progress through different hosting arrangements. In other words, it would be far simpler, I think, to uplift, of course, as the Minister says, uplift universally. It doesn't matter when you start volunteering, you're just making the same good contribution to welcoming Ukrainians.
It seems strange.
It's going to be really challenging because, as we've already heard, and as we know is potentially going to be happening with the disembarkation from Ambition, there's the potential for people to move into different local authority areas. That will be the case from hosted accommodation, temporary accommodation, long-term accommodation. So there are relatively simple ways that this could be resolved. It's going to take well. And to be fair, I don't think the blocker here is with my ministerial counterparts with responsibility for Ukraine. I think it's encouragement of the Treasury that is required to see both this and the tariff payments to local authorities resolved. And so we'll continue to do what we can to try to impress on them of that need.
As you rightly said, Minister, all our thanks go to the people who have stepped up to host, and the last thing we want to do is create a situation of disparity for them or a level of unfairness that might have seen. So thank you for your work in that area, and also thank you for your commitment to provide Ms Boyack with the further information from committee this morning.
I'm happy to provide it to the committee purely to Ms Boyack.
Mr Cameron, you'd have a question.
Thank you, Convener. Just you touched on this in your last answer, Minister, but one thing I raised last week with local authority witnesses was this question of transition from quote short-term accommodation to longer-term accommodation, wherever that is, and the fact that the importance of continuity, particularly in education settings for children and in employment settings for adults, and the challenges that might be posed if a Ukrainian individual or a family moves from one local authority to another or within a local authority area, a larger local authority area. What's the Scottish Government doing to help out effectively?
It's undoubtedly a challenge, and it's one of the things that I was foremost in the discussions that I had with Mr. Cousley when I met him. It was around ensuring as minimal as possible disruption to people as they're moving, particularly from the ships, but also from hotel accommodation as well. And he, as I said, has given a commitment to come with me to Ambition, I hope, next week in order to help to communicate what is available and the support that's in place and give some reassurance around some of that work. First of all, I want to say that I'm very heartened by the fact that Ukrainians who have arrived in Scotland, albeit in temporary accommodation, have been able to put down roots, have been able to establish themselves in schools, in employment and other community settings. That is obviously what we want to see. It does pose a challenge when we're then, you know, the temporary accommodation is by its nature temporary, and so there is going to be an element of disruption in terms of when people move on from that. We're looking to do what we can to offer accommodation where we can, as close as possible to where they have been based. That's not always going to be possible, which is why we've had a number of local authorities from across Scotland go on to the ship onto Ambition in the last few weeks, and there is, I think it's 50 families that are likely to move to Aberdeenshire in the coming period, because we also want to impress on people the opportunities there are for employment, schooling, housing across Scotland, not just in the Central Belt. And I think this is actually something that I raised in my last appearance to the committee in June, was the opportunities that there are for people to move around Scotland and to be able to rebuild their lives from there. We'll work closely, obviously, with Mr. Cousley, with our local authority partners, and not just those that have direct involvement in terms of the hosting of the temporary accommodation, so Ambition's case, Glasgow, but the neighbouring authorities as well, to see what we can do to offer accommodation that would allow people to still be able to commute easily or to be able to go to school where they have already settled. But I must stress, obviously, because of the nature of temporary accommodation, you know, there is going to be an element of disruption. I have to say, finally, that the National Matching Service has become very successful. We're now approaching, I think, 4,000 people that have been matched from temporary accommodation into longer-term accommodation, whether that's hosted or longer-term accommodation, private housing or social housing. And the conversations with people in the matching service continue with those on the ships and those in hotels to try to ensure that people can move on to areas that are of their choosing and will suit their needs, both in terms of education and employment.
Thank you.
Mr. Goulton.
Thank you, Convener. We've heard about pressures on accommodation, but and there's a large caveat to this, given how the war in Ukraine could progress, but we're hearing warnings coming out of the country of a new Russian offensive. Mm. And in that context, I wonder if there's emergency contingency plans in place if there's a large, fresh influx of Ukrainians wishing to come to Scotland.
So, yes, we continue to monitor the situation in terms of the war, because that's our best way of predicting what movement might be like. Obviously, the scheme itself is paused, so it's only those who are in receipt of a super sponsor visa already, over 13,500 that are still to travel, or those that have managed to find a private host through what is available UK-wide that would be able to travel. But yes, that is something that we keep a constant eye on and ensure that we would be looking to procure the necessary temporary accommodation to keep up, or indeed, as Mr. Goulden points out, the contingency that there would be beyond that, where you know, where we see elsewhere in Europe where there has been a larger movement of people, which would be you know, your more typical refugee accommodation, which we have been seeking to avoid clearly up until now, to ensure that people that arrive here are given the best possible start. But all of those considerations are kept under review to ensure that we're able to offer appropriate or accommodation as best we possibly can.
Thanks for that. I'm also keen to hear your views on how important Scotland's third sector has been in supporting displaced Ukrainians, and if they have the resources that they require in order to do this.
Yeah, I mean, again, as I think I did in my introduction, pay tribute to the third sector, as I've done to our local authority partners. You know, Scottish Refugee Council are obviously, you know, very key partners for us in terms of the implementation, in terms of the welcome arrangements, in terms of the delivery of our response, and ensure that everything we are doing is sense checked. But also in individual communities and across Scotland, you know, third sector organisations, as they do for you know, people already resident in Scotland, do a phenomenal job to help and support people who have arrived from Ukraine. I've seen wonderful work in my own constituency in Airdrie and Shotts and wider North Lanarkshire, as well as you know, across Scotland when I've been out on visits, such as in Aberfeldy, which is, you know, that the community there has really done an incredible job in terms of providing the help and support for people from Ukraine. In terms of whether they themselves are getting the necessary support. I would always say that they can come and speak to us if they are needing more support. We provide funding. I'll bring Will in on the exact figures. To third sector interfaces across Scotland to make sure that there can be money and support distributed. I don't know if, Will, you've got the exact support that...
I do, and also to mention the third sector reference group that the Minister will start to chair. It's a new, as part of the review, we took forward a decision to better integrate, I think, the understanding that the third sector has on the ground and to understand it, to coordinate that. So over 77,000 has been provided to Edinburgh Third Sector Interface, more than 1.3 million to the Scottish Refugee Council. There's obviously a package of support that goes beyond that in terms of Ukraine Advice Scotland and of course, British Red Cross. But I think the new ministerial-led third sector group will be the really key platform to make decisions on how best to support the third sector moving into next financial year.
Thanks for that. Back to you, Convener.
Thank you. Final question, I hope, Minister. You mentioned the suspension of the super sponsor scheme and the context of the other schemes that were open in the UK at that time. When is that likely to be reviewed, and how can you update the committee on progress in that area?
Thank you for that, Convener. Yeah, it's under constant review, as would be expected. The last statement that I made to Parliament confirmed that it would remain paused. Discussion is going to be had with the Programme Delivery Board in the coming weeks, and I'll be able to furnish the committee with the outcome of that. But a decision on the current status is going to be required this month, so I'll make sure that the committee is furnished with the outcome of that.
I think that does exhaust questions this morning. Just before we move into private session, can I thank the Minister and his colleagues for their attendance this morning, and we look forward to having full participation in the events that you've mentioned, marking a year since the start of the war that we hope will be over as soon as possible. Apparently the microphone did not pick up the start of the committee, so I have to ask for official parliamentary process if my colleagues are content to take agenda item 3 and 4 in private.
Yes.
Yes, thank you very much. And on that note, we move into private session.